Phosphorescence is a fascinating phenomenon when an object can glow in the dark without needing a continuous supply of electricity. This effect has a wide range of applications, from glow-in-the-dark toys and emergency exit signs to biological imaging. While the ability to emit light without electricity is remarkable, the science behind how it works is even more intriguing. In this video, I'll explore the principles of phosphorescence, which have deep roots in quantum mechanics. I'll make the explanation as accessible as possible, though some basic knowledge of quantum mechanics will be helpful. If you are new to the topic, I recommend checking out some of the other videos on this channel before diving back into this one. To understand how phosphorescence works, we first need to examine the interaction of individual molecules with light. There are two important types of motion within a molecule we need to consider: the motion of the electrons and the vibration of the molecule itself. On the molecular scale, the energy of both motions is quantized, meaning they exist only in specific levels, unlike in classical physics. To determine these energy levels and the corresponding quantum states of the molecule, we need to solve the Schrödinger equation, which takes the form on the screen. This equation indicates that the Hamiltonian operator H acts on a quantum state n to yield the same state multiplied by constant En, which represents the energy. Although the notation is simple, solving this equation is quite complex, especially for the electronic motion in the molecule. The Hamiltonian must account for the kinetic energy of both the electrons and the nuclei, as well as all the possible interactions between them. This is typically handled using computational methods. Each electronic energy level is associated with multiple vibrational energy levels, which are much more closely spaced than the electronic levels. We typically represent these vibrational levels as thinner lines within the electronic energy levels. The energy gaps of the electronic energy levels are typically in the visible light region. Before diving into phosphorescence, let's explore a simpler process: fluorescence. Fluorescence occurs when a substance emits light as it absorbs energy. Imagine a molecule in its electronic and vibrational ground state. To excite it, the molecule absorbs a photon whose energy matches the difference between the two energy levels. If the molecule reaches a vibrationally excited state, it can lose energy through collisions with surrounding solvent molecules. Eventually, the molecule returns to its electronic ground state by emitting a photon. The emitted light typically has a longer wavelength because some of the energy is lost to thermal motion. A common example of fluorescence is dyes glowing under UV light. Next, we need to consider the concept of spin in quantum mechanics. Electrons possess an intrinsic property called spin, which gives them a magnetic moment, causing them to behave like tiny magnets. An electron can be in one or two spin states: spin up or spin down. They satisfy the following equations for spin operator in the z direction, SZ. When two electrons are spin paired, their spins cancel out, resulting in a singlet state, which has no magnetic moment. When the spins are unpaired, the electrons form a triplet state, named because there are three ways the spins can be arranged. The state has twice the magnetic moment of a single electron. Although T0 looks like the spins are pointing in opposite directions, in reality, the spins are aligned in the same direction in the XY plane. Now, let's examine the transitions between these states in more detail. The intensity of a transition is given by the formula displayed on the screen. F mu I is called transition dipole moment. It is a measure of the strength of dipolar migration of the charge when the molecule makes a transition from the initial state I to final state F. The dipole moment operator mu is given by E times R1 plus R2, where E is the charge on electron, and R1 and R2 are the position operators of the two electrons. For light emission to occur, the transition dipole moment must be non-zero. Now consider what happens to the total spin state when we swap the labels on the two electrons. The dipole moment operator remains unchanged since the sum of the two distances stays the same. The triplet state remains unchanged upon the label swap. Singlet state becomes the negative of itself. Thus, the transition dipole moment remains the same for singlet-singlet and triplet-triplet transitions, but becomes negative when swapping the labels for singlet-triplet transition. Since the transition dipole moment quantifies the strength of the dipolar migration of charge during a transition, it cannot be dependent on how we label the electrons. The only number that equals to its own negative is zero. This forms the basis of selection rule that forbids singlet-triplet transitions. As a result, singlet-singlet and triplet-triplet transitions can have non-zero intensity, while singlet-triplet transitions must have zero intensity. However, there's a complication. Electrons behave like tiny magnets due to their spin, and their orbital motion generates a magnetic field. This field interacts with the electron's magnetic moment, leading to spin-orbit coupling. As a result, the electron's spin can flip, enabling transitions between singlet and triplet states. Let's now explore how the interaction between an electron's orbital motion and spin in the z direction facilitates this transition. The spin-orbit Hamiltonian is given by the product of the spin and orbital angular momentum operators Lz for each electron. We then rewrite the expression and examine the effect of the spin operators in the second term on the singlet state. We expand the terms, then substituting the actions of S1z and S2z on the spin states. Then we simplify and recognize this as the triplet state T0. Thus, we have demonstrated that spin-orbit coupling can convert the singlet state into the triplet state T0. In this example, we considered the interaction in the z direction, but a similar analysis shows that the interactions in the x and y directions can convert the singlet state into other triplet states T+ and T-. Furthermore, spin-orbit coupling can also facilitate the reverse process, converting a triplet state back to a singlet. Although this process is possible, it occurs much more slowly than the initial excitation and thermal relaxation. The key difference between phosphorescence and fluorescence lies in this change of spin state. Now, we can fully understand the phosphorescence process. Initially, the molecule is in a singlet ground state, both electronically and vibrationally. After absorbing a photon, it is excited into a higher energy level. The molecule can then lose vibrational energy through collisions with its surrounding molecules. If this process is not too fast, the molecule undergoes a spin state conversion from the singlet to the triplet state in a process called intersystem crossing. Intersystem crossing is a spin-orbit coupling effect. From there, the molecule continues to lose thermal energy until it reaches the ground vibrational state of the triplet state. At this point, the transition back to singlet ground state is forbidden by the selection rule. However, spin-orbit coupling weakly relaxes the rule, allowing the transition to occur slowly, resulting in the emission of light over an extended period. Thanks for watching.